So I'll be talking you through why I think APIs are the products of the 21st century, and basically why I think you as a business should be doing APIs, or rather considering APIs and products. What are the benefits that you will get out of it, and how you can think of your APIs as products. What are the things that you need to do as an organization and technically in order to achieve this milestone of treating your APIs as products. So to begin with, I'd like to talk about what a product is. So I'm sure everyone has an opinion on this, an idea on this. So it's basically anything that is used to satisfy the desire of a customer, the desire or a need of a customer, of a consumer. That's basically what a product is, right? So it can be offered for free. It can be offered it can be offered commercially. Nevertheless, a product is something that solves a particular problem for you, for a particular consumer of the product. So if you think of Google search, that is basically a very simple example of a product, simple in the sense in what it does, not how it does it. So Google search is basically a product that I'm sure all of us have used or are using at the moment as well. And it's offered to us as free. But that's really what we think. It's not really free if you really think about it. So we don't really use our credit card to, you know, do a Google search, which is true. But we do actually pay Google with all of our data by letting Google know our search preferences, our interests, and things like that. So all of this data is used by Google for various other reasons, for placing ads strategically and for giving you various kinds of results based on what you search for. So that's basically one example of a very simple product. So, and I'm sure all of you who are joining are in some kind of a business, and you provide your business value to your customers. Now, the richness of your business value actually lies in whatever the data that you have about your customers and the processes or the services that you run on top of that data. That's basically where all of your wealth lies in. So if you think of Google, if you think of Google search, the wealth of Google search is basically in its data. So Google search's data is basically an index of the whole World Wide Web, right? So they have stored all of these indexes in their data centers, and they run very complicated processes, algorithms, and, you know, the analysis on this data. That basically is what is considered as the wealth of Google search. And we consume Google search in various forms. Like, we use various kinds of applications, various kinds of devices to consume Google search. So, for example, the address bar on our web browser is now a client to the Google search API. The Google search webpage, google.com, is basically an application to Google search. And we have the Google search mobile application and so on, right? So users consume the value of your business or the richness of your business through some form of an application. And all of this is powered by some kind of an API. So while it is true that users would consume some form of an application to get the value of your business, those applications become the device or the medium of them consuming that value. And APIs become the delivery mechanism of that value. It's basically APIs that take the richness of your business and provide it to various kinds of applications. That's basically what the Google Search API is all about. There are numerous consumers of it, and all of this has been made possible by the Google Search API, that is basically acting as the medium of transporting this value or delivering this value to its consumers. So if you look at the application market, which is where users consume these values mostly. So the two most popular application markets out there in the world has been there for about just over a decade now. And you can see the increase in applications or the number of applications they've added. And this is all because this application market is giving value to the user. It's making the user's life easier, efficient, or cheaper, or faster in some way. So the Play Store has close to about 3 million apps This was in Q1 20 this year, and the Apple App Store has about 2.2 million apps. So all of these apps are basically adding value, and that's why we see a significant growth of not just the number of apps, but also the revenue that it has brought in. So this year, the mobile application revenue is close, expected to grow to about $200 billion, right? So that speaks the value these applications give to the users. And thinking about value, you should perceive value slightly differently. So value is something that makes your customer better in some way, something more delightful, something more delicious, right? So a customer uses a particular product. It could be an application of some sort, right? A customer uses a particular product to get the value out of it. And this is really where our sales should be focused on, right? Our value should actually be focused on not just the product that we are trying to sell, but on what it makes the customer at the end of the day, what the customer becomes at the end of the day. So value is basically a combination of your customer's assets or problems that he has and the product that is being added on top of it to make the customer something better than he or she actually was in the beginning. So this is actually the value that we are talking about, and value is basically what we should be selling to our customers. And how do you get this value out, right? How do you think of this value? How do you perceive this value? So I think when you are building this value proposition of your organization, which could be in the banking industry, in insurance, in retail, it doesn't really matter. So to build your value proposition, I think there are four main areas that you should be focusing on. First is to pick the proper customer, right? Like you should have pick the correct customer and understand what the issues that they're going through, like what are the problems they are having, what are the inefficiencies they are having, how can you make their life cheaper or more efficient. And you should understand what they want to get to as well. Where does your customer want to get to? What are their goals and so on? And know the business assets that you have so that you can use them to help that customer, right? So if you understand these four things, you can easily build your value proposition. So that's basically the first step of treating your APIs as products, realizing what the value proposition of your business is, of your organization is. And then APIs become the interface for delivering this value proposition to your customers. So APIs are basically building the entire digital platform or digital experience that we are talking about, right? So think about a scenario where you'd want to, you want to find a date, right? And so you can basically use the Facebook APIs and find your friends or friends of friends who are of the right gender that you're looking for, of the right age group that you're looking for, living in the same city as you are, and so on, right? And then so using that, you can find potential matches. And then you can use Yelp's APIs basically to find a restaurant that looks good enough, right? That's close, that has good ratings and so on. And you can use Yelp's APIs to make a reservation. And then to pick a date, you can basically use Google Calendar APIs, right? And you can basically build an application like this that uses these different APIs behind the scenes and give you that digital experience. And there are actually applications that are doing the same thing or something very similar using these kinds of APIs behind the scenes. So all of this digital experience that we are experiencing ourselves through different forms of applications are all powered by different types of APIs like this. And the integration of these different APIs creates endless possibilities for us as a business and as an ecosystem as well. So APIs become that interface of delivering that value proposition of your organization. And I think APIs do two really valuable things. One is that it connects your customers to your data and services, which is basically where your richness lies in. And it does that in a really simple way, right? So if you have heard about Plaid, Plaid is a company that took a lot of legacy banking services of different banks and offered them as simple and easily consumable APIs, like modern APIs, right? So that was basically what they did. And they become an incredibly valuable company because of this, because that enabled various financial applications to integrate with different kinds of banking systems. And this simple hard work of Plaid that did the simplification process of taking banking services and APIs and exposing them as simple APIs out into the market made them an extremely valuable company. Just that. And they were bought out for about $5 billion by Visa some time ago, right? So that's basically what APIs can enable for you as a business. And we've been talking about value and figuring out what your customers really want and where they want to get you and how you can help them. But also, APIs are also useful for making future business ideas and thoughts a possibility. So I'm sure some of you have heard about the what we call the Bezos mandate, which is like a mandate brought in by Amazon's CEO, Jeff Bezos. So sometime back, he set a mandate at Amazon saying every service in Amazon needs to be exposed as an API. And there are no exemptions to this rule. Everything has to be exposed as an API. Now, a long time since then, now if you think of the services that Amazon is offering in the form of different kinds of applications and services, I'm pretty sure Bezos did not envision all these things that Amazon is providing today, right? So, but what made those things possible is that mandate which said every service that Amazon is offering has to be exposed as an API. And once that is exposed as an API, as you grow as a business and as you start gathering ideas, as the market changes, you see lots of new opportunities coming in and you get ideas of what new things you could do, what new products you can build, what new services you can give, and so on. And to make those things a possibility, APIs become the medium of making those things a possibility. So that APIs are not just useful for giving the value that you can pursue today as a business, but it also sets the foundation for coming up with creative business ideas and executing them in the future and doing it pretty fast as well, right? So to make all of this possible, what you as an organization, as a company that has data and services and it's dealing with problems in a certain vertical, business vertical, need to convert yourself, organization, into what we call as an API native company, right? So to do this, you need to establish what we call an API product factory within your organization. Basically a mechanism of taking your APIs or business services and converting them into API products. So these have to be treated as products if we are to generate this value that we are talking of with APIs. So this basically involves first of all, manufacturing your API, meaning building your API. So use various programming languages, various protocols, various kinds of integrations between systems to build or implement your API. And then comes the assembly part. So you as a business would have multiple different kinds of services in different places. So creating an API is simply not an act of taking this service and exposing it as is. It's a matter of assembling them in such a way that it makes sense for a certain application to consume it. So then comes the assembly part and the packaging of it. So packaging basically is a matter of documenting it, like making sure you attach the relevant business plans to it, making sure you categorize it in the proper way for the proper audience and so on. And delivering it. So once you've done the packaging, it's a matter of delivering this API to your consumers. So for this, you need to figure out where your consumers are going to be and where they will be in the future as well. And based on that, you decide where your API delivery platforms are going to be is it going to be on the cloud? Is it going to be on-prem? Is it going to be advertised in your own marketplace, in third-party marketplaces, and all of that? And finally, all of these things need to be done in an automated fashion. So you're not going to be very efficient if you think of doing all of this as a manual process. It's like highly prone to error and all of that. So you need to bring in automation, basically mechanisms of taking a technical API and going through an automated process of converting it into a business product fully automated fashion. So this process that we are talking about, everything from assembly, packaging, and delivery needs to be automated. So you as an organization need to think about how you can get to this stage and how you can establish this thing called the API product factory. So the WSO2 platform can help you get there with the components that it has. So we have the like most of you must be knowing about the API management platform, which has like three main components to it, which we call the management plane, data plane, and the control plane. The management plane basically is the developer platforms and the business analytics. So this is where API developers would come in and design the interfaces for the API, where application developers would come in and consume the APIs, read the documentation, subscribe to APIs, and so on. And then you have the business insights, which tell you how your APIs are doing, whether they are meeting your business KPIs, and so on. The data plane is basically about the delivery mechanism of the API. So this is where the various flavors of API gateways come into the picture. So you have the server mode gateway, which we call as a regular gateway, and we have a lightweight, fast micro gateway, and various integrations to Kubernetes and service meshes, and so on. So this is where the delivery platform of the API is, and this is where all of your consumers, the end users, would be coming in through their devices. And we also have the what we call the control plane, which is all about governance. So the control plane takes control of your APIs, like who it is being exposed to, who these APIs are being visible to, and who can access these APIs, and at what rate, and all of those information. And it also checks for abnormalities and things like that. So that's basically about the API exposure layer. And then we have the integration platform, which basically helps you to do the implementation as well as the assembly of the APIs. So integration becomes a very critically important piece in your architecture, because as I said before, exposing APIs is not just a simple act of taking a service and exposing it as is. It's also a matter of integrating different pieces together to build a delightful custom experience for the consumers of the API. And identity and access management, of course, becomes important for the security aspects of it, like to bring in single sign-on into your applications, to do things like identity federation. So if you want to enable like social media login for the applications that you're building, this becomes important. This becomes an important piece in your architecture to address all forms and flavors of security aspects in your platform. So this platform as a whole can be used to build what I explained earlier as the API factory. So now I hope you understand like APIs and API products are kind of two different things, in the sense that API products have a much more business sense and a business value to it. So if APIs are becoming your organization's products, then what you also have is a new customer base. So you will have your regular customers who are like, who could be like your insurance firm's customers, your bank's customers, and so on. But with APIs becoming your products, you also have a new customer base who are developers, right? So you need to cater to these developers so that they can build delightful experiences for your actual customers of the business. So if developers are your customers, then you have to think about how can you make your APIs better, and how can you serve this new customer base better now? So one of the first most important things in making your APIs interesting to your developers is to make it discoverable. So this is where what we call an API user portal, or a API store as we used to call it, comes into the picture. So you need to figure out how you can make your APIs as discoverable to the developers as possible. So there are various features like tagging, categorizing, and various flavors of search that you should enable so that your APIs become discoverable to developers. And what you see on the right is basically a portal of the New Zealand government industry, where they have used categorized APIs by ministry. So that's basically a very simple example of how you can categorize APIs and make them more discoverable to the interested audiences. And a very key important factor is to make your APIs easy to use. So this is all about making your APIs as intuitive as possible, like making it simple so that you really don't have to read a documentation to understand it, at least most part of it. Right. So you should think about giving a sandbox environment for developers to try out. And of course, documentation. So documentation becomes important. Technical documentation, of course, we all understand why it's important. But business documentation is also important. So this business documentation can help make the case for the business or the management side of the developers who are going to consume this API. So your API should also speak business language, in the sense it should try to sell itself by saying that it will either earn additional revenue for your organization, it will either make your processes more efficient, it will cut down your operational costs, and so on. So that having that business documentation makes it very important, so that your developers can make a case for their management to consume and build applications on this. And you also need to think about automating the API development lifecycle. So this is basically a picture of the API automation lifecycle we have in place with the WSO2 API manager at the moment. So this is also very important. Basically, your developers really don't like to go through the aspects of business documentation and all of that, right? So this is where an API product manager role comes into play. So you should build processes in such a way where the people can do what they like doing, and you can get the desired product at the end of the day as well. So basically, this is talking about a scenario where an API developer can basically write the code, test it out, and once it's working fine, commit it to a repository and be done with their job, right? And this will take the API into a different stage where the API product manager can come in and associate the relevant business plans, and then associate whatever the business documentation and so on, and do its job. So another key aspect of a good API is that it is safe to use. So you have to think about security very critically. So usually ease of use and security don't go hand in hand. What we've seen a lot is that the more secure your systems are, the more hard it is to use, and it's for obvious reasons. But it doesn't necessarily have to be that way. So there are new protocols that can that you can enable on your APIs that not only make it more safer, but also make it more convenient to use. Things like biometric-based authentication, right? So they are quite safer than password-based systems, and it's more easier to use as well, right? So there are new protocols and new features that are available to make your APIs safer. And one mistake that I've seen many organizations do when it comes to API security is that most of them stop thinking about security at the point of authentication and authorization, right? So, but API security goes a lot more deeper than that, right? There are attacks being done on APIs through malicious payloads, through DOS attacks, and a lot of these similar kind of attacks. So authentication and authorization probably gets you halfway, like 50%, but there are a lot more things that you need to think about when thinking about end-to-end API security. And one of those being that you have to monitor the system to look for abnormalities as well. Because there are no authentication failures and so on, doesn't mean that your system is that everything is fine. There can be intruders in the system who are using stolen credentials and so on. And when most of us are, I'm sure, are thinking about going into cloud native architectures and so on, And one of the most critically important aspects here is to make your APIs scale to demand. So if you set up systems or cloud architectures in a traditional way, basically, when I say traditional way, what we used to do in the past is to identify what our peak load is going to be in our system and then do capacity planning to cater that peak load plus a bit more, right? But if you're thinking of cloud native systems, this is going to be very expensive because you are going to be running the system at a scale that you're rarely going to need, which means you're wasting a lot of money. So that is why it's important to have an elastic system where your system scales up when there's a demand for higher, when there's a high demand, and then scales down when the demand goes down. So this is where it's important that you build what we call as an elastic data plane. So the data plane is basically the layer that takes all of your business transactions. So this data plane has to be elastic in the sense that it can scale up and scale down. And not just that, it can even scale across cloud providers and on-prem systems if required. So that's basically how you solve that particular problem. It's also important that you have a product management lifecycle to improve your APIs. So improving these APIs is a lot about monitoring them both for business KPIs as well as for operational KPIs. So business KPIs are basically things like, does this API meet my revenue goals and things like that. Operational KPIs are things like uptime, error, and so on. Now, a few minutes ago, I mentioned that developers are also now going to be your customers, which means that a developer NPS or Net Promoter Score is going to be critically important as well. So you need to get feedback from developers about how your API is performing, what additional features they would like, and build a system or processes that can treat your developers as customers and give them what they are looking for. And then, of course, after you set up all this monitoring, you have to use capabilities like lifecycle management and versioning of APIs to basically improve or basically iterate on your API. And finally, think about what the business model of your API is going to be, right? So there is, when it comes to business model, there are implicit and explicit forms of monetization. So if you think of the Google Search API, that's an implicit form of monetization for Google Search. Basically, they don't charge you directly, but they charge you indirectly by selling you stuff and so on. But there are explicit monetization examples as well. So if you think of companies like Stripe or Twilio and so on, they explicitly charge you for using your API. So this could also be one monetization strategy for your APIs. And there are various forms of monetization that you can think about in the explicit world and the implicit world as well. And your API may not be like, you know, at all earning revenue in any way, either implicitly or explicitly, right? Your API could even be an API that is used to cut down your operational costs for your organization. So think of a self-care application for your organization, right? So that kind of an application can basically cut down the number of calls that you're getting to your call center, right? Which means you can reduce the operational costs of your call center, right? So that can also be a business model for your API product. So that basically brings me to the conclusion of my session. And to conclude, I'd like to make two announcements. That is like, this is probably something you've already heard about. So Forrester recently concluded the analysis on API management solution. And we are proud to be positioned as a leader here with four other vendors. So you can download the link when you receive the slides from the link below. And also we just released WSO2 API Manager version 3.2. So these are the key features that we released with this version. So it's on the website now. And the documentation has also been updated to reflect the latest features and so on. So we are launching this today. We just launched it actually just before the summit. So you can now go ahead and use the latest version of it as well. So thank you so much.